Park chairman, and also our the presenter today is our student is Dr. Shahana Rahman. Dr. Shahana Rahman, she is resident in Gynae Oncology, Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujib Medical University. Before the starting our session, they, as routinely, we are starting the poll questions. And I request Mrs. Fatima Sharna to show your poll question, please. And all the participants are requested to answer the poll questions. And at the end of the session, again, the questions will be shown. And again, you will answer. And we want to know that before the starting the session and after session, how many percentages are the correct? And at the end of the session, the three persons will be selected for the giving the prizes. So all are requested to for poll voting.
Now going on.
At the end of the poll session. Mona?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yes, the end of the poll session. So now I request Dr. Shahana Rahman. At first, this month we have started the endometrial carcinoma. Last time we have completed the carcinoma cervix, and after completion of the carcinoma cervix, we had a full-time workshop on carcinoma cervix. And this month, even after Ramadan, we are going on these sessions, and it is the short time, that is 1.5 hours. Usually it is 2 hours. And at the end of this month, and probably at the middle of May, we want to arrange another session on endometrial carcinoma at the workshop at full day, full-time workshop and the endometrial carcinoma. And at the part of the day today, Dr. Shahana Rahman, she will present the surgical management of the endometrial carcinoma, and our faculty, Dr. Bhagyalakshmi Nayak, she will supplement her presentation, and also she will show you the video presentation. Dr. Shahana Rahman, please go through your presentation.
Madam, am I audible, ma'am?
Yes, you are.
Can you see my slides?
Yes.
Can you see slide my?
Yes, yes, yes. Just a minute, Anna, please. Sir. Hi, sir. Hi, sir.
Hello.
That sound, sir. Sorry, after a year.
No problem.
Thank you.
Respected Chairperson, distinguished faculties from home and abroad, and the learned audience. Assalamu alaikum. I'm Dr. Shahana Rahman, FCPS subspecialty student from Department of Gynecological Oncology, Bangabandhu Sheikh Mujib Medical University, Dhaka. Today, I'm going to talk on surgical management of endometrial cancer. At first, take a look on 2009 FIGO staging for endometrial carcinoma. When the tumor is confined to the corpus, it is stage 1. When the tumor invades the cervical stroma, it is stage 2. And when the tumor invades the adnexa, serosa, vagina, parametrium, or lymph node, it is stage 3. And when the tumor invades bladder, rectum, or metastasized to distant site, it is stage 4. The cornerstone for treatment is the total hysterectomy and bilateral sulfingophorectomy. But why the ovaries should be removed? As ovaries may be the site of micrometastasis, risk of ovarian cancer is more in endometrial cancer patient, and synchronous ovarian cancer may be present. But what will be the approaches? Minimal invasive surgery, total abdominal hysterectomy, or vaginal hysterectomy? Minimally invasive surgery. According to the FIGO cancer report 2018, cancer of the corpus uteri said that laparoscopic procedure have increasingly been introduced as standard, especially for early stage disease, as they have been proven safe and reduce acute treatment related complications. And what are the evidences? In LACE trial, women with stage 1 endometrial cancer randomized to either total laparoscopic hysterectomy or total abdominal hysterectomy. Disease-free survival was 81.3% in total abdominal hysterectomy group and 81.6% in total laparoscopic group. No difference in overall survival. The findings supported the use of laparoscopic hysterectomy for women with stage 1 endometrial cancer. GOG conducted this lab-2 trial to determine the equivalency in early stage endometrial cancer outcomes between laparoscopy-assisted vaginal hysterectomy and bilateral sulfingophorectomy with surgical staging and traditional open surgery. 5-year survival was similar in both arms, though concluded that surgical staging with operative laparoscopy followed by vaginal hysterectomy or total laparoscopic hysterectomy, which was proposed as an alternative to laparotomy. According to ASTRO-ESP guidelines, the surgical management for apparent stage 1 or 2 endometrial cancer, minimally invasive surgery is the preferred surgical approach, including patients with high-risk endometrial carcinoma. Level of evidence 1 and grade of recommendation A. NCCN also recommend the total hysterectomy and bilateral sulfingophorectomy for disease confined to uterus, and minimally invasive surgery is the preferred approach when technically feasible. As we know, maximum in cancer, endometrial cancer occurred in the above the 50 years or older patient, but approximately 5% of the endometrial cancer occur in women aged 40 years or younger. Most women have a history of chronic anovulation. 10% occur in association with the Lynch syndrome, usually well-differentiated tumor, and fertility preservation is often a concern. So, hysteroscopic resection with progesterone therapy may be an option for this group of patients. In this trial, women aged 40 years or younger with stage 1A, grade 1-2 endometrial carcinoma, the hysteroscopy resection was used to resect the tumor lesion, the endometrium adjacent to the tumor, and the myometrium underlying the tumor. Levonorgestrel IUD added for at least 6 months. And 85.7% showed a complete regression. And this result seemed that hysteroscopic resection improved the efficacy of the progesterone. But this approach is still experimental. According to ASTRO-ESP guidelines, fertility-sparing treatment should be considered only in patients with grade 1 endometrial carcinoma without myometrial invasion and without genetic risk factor. Radiologic imaging to assess the extension of the disease must be performed. Patient must be informed that fertility-sparing treatment is not a standard treatment. Level of evidence 5 and grade of recommendation A here. And patient must be informed of the need for future hysterectomy in case of failure of treatment and or after pregnancy. NCCN recommends also the same here, so I will skip this slide. Regarding ovarian preservation, ESGO recommend that it can be considered in premenopausal patient 40 years or younger with low grade endometrioid endometrial carcinoma with myometrial invasion less than 50% and no obvious ovarian or other extrauterine disease. In cases of ovarian preservation, self-injectomy is recommended. And ovarian preservation is not recommended for patients with cancer family history involving ovarian cancer risk like BRCA mutation, Lynch syndrome, etc. Now coming to surgical staging. Patients with stage 1 and occult stage 2 endometrial cancer who require surgical staging are grade 3 tumors, grade 2 tumors more than 2 cm in diameter, clear cell or serous carcinoma, more than 50% of myometrial invasion and cervical extension. And the decision based on histopathology from the uterine Q ratings, gross findings on opening of the uterus in operating table and frozen section of the resected uterus. And generally the abdomen is opened by midline vertical incision. The peritoneal washings are taken for cytology, careful exploration of the intra-abdominal contents. Any suspicious lesions are excised or biopsied. Biopsy taken from omentum or infraocular omentectomy in serous or carcinosarcoma or undifferentiated endometrioid tumor. And careful palpation for suspicious or enlarged pelvic and para-aortic nodes. NCCN also recommend that in type 2 carcinoma who are suitable for primary surgery should undergo total hysterectomy, bilateral sulfingophorectomy, surgical staging followed by adjuvant therapy. Now lymphadenectomy. It is a matter of debate whether routinely pelvic lymphadenectomy should be done or not. Role of lymphadenectomy to assign a surgical stage to provide a prognostic information to direct adjuvant radiation. But the risks are increase in operating time, potential for vascular injury, genitofemoral nerve injury, lymphocyst formation, and lymphedema. Now, what are the evidences? In ESTEC trial, patients with clinical stage 1 endometrial carcinoma randomized to surgery with or without pelvic lymphadenectomy. No evidence of benefit in terms of overall or recurrence-free survival for pelvic lymphadenectomy, and they concluded that pelvic lymphadenectomy cannot be recommended as a routine procedure. In CONSORT trial, preoperative stage 1 endometrial cancer were randomized to surgery with or without pelvic lymphadenectomy. 5-year disease-free survival and overall survival rates are similar between the arms, and they concluded systematic pelvic lymphadenectomy did not improve disease-free or overall survival. As ESTEC and CONSORT trial both speaks against the routine lymphadenectomy, but both the trial are strongly criticized for their weaknesses, like the absence of treatment in patients identified with the positive nodes, lack of prescribed adjuvant therapy, limited power to show improvements in outcome, poor quality of the lymph node dissection, absence of paraaortic nodal dissection, lack of quality of life assessment evaluating the effect of both surgery and adjuvant therapy, and over-representation of the low-risk patient in both the trial. On the other hand, in SEPAL study, it was evaluated whether systematic pelvic and para-aortic lymphadenectomy should be part of the surgical therapy for patients with intermediate and high risk of recurrence. Overall survival was significantly longer in the pelvic and para-aortic lymphadenectomy group than in the pelvic lymphadenectomy group. And they concluded that pelvic and para-aortic lymphadenectomy for the treatment of patients with intermediate and high risk of recurrence. So, sentinel lymph node mapping may be an alternative here. The hypothesis is if the sentinel lymph node is negative, the other regional lymph node will be negative. Thus, the routine lymphadenectomy and associated hazard can be avoided thereby. Here, a blue dye with or without a radioactive tracer or indocyanine green dye are used for sentinel lymph node mapping, and the approaches are injection into the cervix, injection around the tumor via hysteroscope, injection into the subserosal myometrium at the fundus. In FIRES trial, a standardized cervical injection of indocyanine green and sentinel lymph node mapping followed by pelvic lymphadenectomy with or without periotic lymphadenectomy was conducted. Sensitivity to detect node positive disease was 97% and a negative predictive value of 99.6%. So they concluded that sentinel lymph node mapping identified the with indocyanine green have a high degree of diagnostic accuracy in detecting metastasis to the lymph node and can safely replace lymphadenectomy in the staging of endometrial cancer. Now, vaginal hysterectomy. Patients with marked obesity or medical comorbidities which put them in the high surgical risk can be the candidate for vaginal hysterectomy. But the limitations are lack of exploration of the intraperitoneal cavity, inability to procure cytologic washings, difficulty in performing oophorectomy, inability to perform lymph node sampling, but all of which can be overcome by laparoscopy assisted vaginal hysterectomy. And in this study, patient aged 70 years or older and at stages 1 to 3 were operated on the either vaginal hysterectomy or abdominal hysterectomy. 10-year disease specific survival rates after vaginal and abdominal hysterectomy were 80% and 78% respectively. So they concluded that vaginal hysterectomy may be considered the elective approach for treatment of elderly patients with endometrial cancer. Now the question of radical hysterectomy in stage 2 endometrial cancer. In this study, patients with type 1 endometrial cancer and figure 2009 stage 2 who underwent surgical treatment were evaluated from the CR database. Women treated with radical hysterectomy were matched with the women treated with a simple hysterectomy. And they concluded that for patients with stromal cervical invasion and type 1 endometrial cancer, the type of hysterectomy doesn't impact cancer-related or overall survival, even after adjustment for adjuvant radiation. ESGO ESTRO guideline also recommend total hysterectomy with bilateral sulfingooophorectomy and lymph node staging is the surgical standard of care in patients with stage 2 endometrial carcinoma. Level of evidence 4 and grade of recommendation B. And more extensive procedure should only be performed if required to achieve free surgical margin. NCCN also recommend that for stage 2 endometrial cancer, either total hysterectomy or radical hysterectomy and bilateral sulfingooophorectomy and surgical staging could be done. Now, ESGO ESTRO guideline recommends that in stage 3 and 4 endometrial carcinoma, surgical tumor debulking should be considered even when complete macroscopic resection is feasible with an acceptable morbidity and quality of life profile. And primary systemic therapy should be used if upfront surgery is not feasible or acceptable. And only enlarged lymph node should be resected. Systematic lymphadenectomy is not recommended here. NCCN also recommend that patient suspected extrauterine disease when disease confined to the abdomen pelvis and suitable for surgery should undergo either total hysterectomy or bilateral sulfingooophorectomy or plus surgical staging or debulking followed by adjuvant treatment. I'm almost at the end. The role of surgery in recurrent endometrial carcinoma is limited. And surgery is usually combined with the radiotherapy, chemotherapy, or hormone therapy. Only selected patients who will be benefited from this extensive surgery will be suitable for these cases. And types of surgery depends upon the extension of the disease, like surgical resection of an isolated recurrence more than 4 centimeters before giving radiotherapy may improve the local control. And for more extensive disease, cytoreductive surgery or pelvic excentration can be done. So the take-home messages here is the minimally invasive surgery is the preferred approach for hysterectomy when technically feasible. Fertility-sparing treatment for endometrial cancer is not a standard treatment. Normal looking ovaries may be preserved in young patients in absence of any risk factors. And low risk endometrial cancer patients are ideal candidates for sentinel lymph node mapping. And complete pelvic lymphadenectomy is performed only in the high risk endometrial cancer patient. Radical hysterectomy has no survival benefit over extrafascial hysterectomy for stage 2 endometrial cancer. So before concluding, I would like to thank Oncology Club for giving me the opportunity to present in this platform. I express my gratitude to Professor Shahana Parveen ma'am for believing in me that I can do it. And dear audience, thank you for patience hearing.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Shahana, for your nice and elaborating presentation. Before going to the presentation of our faculty, Dr. Bhagyalakshmi Nayak, I would like to request the President Award, Dr. Vijay Ahuja sir, to comment on our the students' presentation.
Yeah, good evening, and thank you for having me here. The presentation was good, but I would like to hear Dr. Bhagyalakshmi first. She's our expert today, and it's always wonderful to hear her. So after she makes her comments, I will add if there's something required.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much. And so I would request the other faculties and also the other participants, senior participants, to comment on their presentation. And before that, I would like to request Dr. Bhagyalakshmi Nayak to go through your presentation and show your presentation.
Thank you so much, Dr. Shahana, for this opportunity. So can I share my screen?
Yes, you are.
I think it was wonderful, her presentation. I think she has covered everything. So, and made my work also very easy. So let me see how fast I can go through it. But I know she has told us a lot about all the guidelines. But I think we can discuss now about what is feasible for us and how we look at those guidelines. So I think the most important thing is about the November 2020 ESGO ESTRO guidelines, which have been guiding us, and the NCCN guidelines. So there has been a little change in that. So let's start before the surgery. So I think there are some guidelines that we should do a proper histopathologic tumor type and grade in the endometrial biopsy before opting for the surgery. And more than that, a preoperative mandatory workup also includes a family history, general assessment, inventory of comorbidities, geriatric assessment if appropriate, clinical examination, including pelvic examination. And at this point of time, I think I would like to mention that transvaginal ultrasound properly done is as good as a pelvic MRI. So in centers where we do not have MRI, I think we should not feel bad that we don't have MRI. So a proper transvaginal ultrasound done with a good transducer gives us enough information about the myo-invasion, about the primary tumor diameter, and about the cervical extension, and maybe the nodal status also at times. So, and at the same time, we have to identify patients also with Lynch syndrome and triage for germline mutational analysis, and plus analysis of MLH1 promoter methylation status in case of immunohistochemical loss of MLH1 and PMS2 expression, or MSI test should be performed in all endometrial carcinomas, irrespective of the histologic subtype of the tumor. So I think this point we all have to remember, that in case it's possible for us to do all these immunomarkers, they are available, all endometrial cancer should undergo all these tests, especially the MSI test. So taking a decision on the extent of surgery, I think for that, we need so many things. We need to know so many things. So the first and foremost I describe is a TV scan of the pelvis. You have a histopathological diagnosis about the grade 1, 2, or 3. What is the histopathological variant? What is the primary tumor diameter and cervical extension? I think we have all this, should have, try to have all this in hand before we go or decide on a surgery. And many times there could be some per-operative findings that could modify it. And a decision on staging is very necessary for histopathology on DNC and or DHEP, not a papal biopsy. Gross findings on opening the uterus in the OR and frozen section of the resected uterus. Having said that, I think I will go back on my version that frozen section of the resected uterus is no more recommended, and we will see that in the coming slides. So I think TV scan pelvis, we should not ignore it. That's a good finding. And about frozen section, I have my reservations. So more recently, we have the TCGA classification of the pole ultra mutated, microsatellite unstable, copy number low and copy number high. So the subsequent studies have shown that combining both the molecular with the clinicopathological risk factors can potentially improve the adjuvant treatment selection for women with high intermediate risk endometrial cancer. For high risk and advanced stage endometrial cancer, several molecular alterations are being explored for targeted therapy. So this is the TCGA classification in which we have four variants basically. And in case it's not possible for you to do all the markers, I think we can only do the P53 marker so that it can tell us about the prognosis of the patient to tailor the management. So prognosis is excellent in the pole mutant variety and is intermediate in MMRD or MSI, and P53 wild type, it's variable, but it is very poor in a P53 mutant variety. So I think in case you are given the option to do one IHC, I think you should advise a P53 for endometrial cancer. So the surgery is called a comprehensive surgical staging, and it includes a type 1 hysterectomy with BSO now. Previously, we were thinking of more radical surgeries, and peritoneal washings, fluid for cytology or washings have to be taken, though alone at singularly, they don't have any prognostic implication, but if the adenoids are positive, we need to know the status of the peritoneal fluid. Exploration of all the abdominopelvic organs, because in case there is a small nodule also on the pouch of Douglas, the stage of the disease becomes a stage 4 disease. So I think a proper exploration is very, very important, along with lymphadenectomy, and we will see what are the indications and what are the contraindications, and a omental biopsy or omentectomy as the case may be. So this type 1 hysterectomy is now there is literature also which shows that a simple hysterectomy is also good enough. So surgery may be limited to hysterectomy and bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy in those patients with grade 1 or 2 endometrioid adenocarcinoma, which appears confined to the uterus. So that was the British Gynec Cancer Society in 2017. And then lymphadenectomy in this instance does not improve survival. We have already heard that from our learned speaker. And patients requiring surgical staging, this again she has described very nicely. But I have a little reservation about this, is that now the recommendation is that the surgical staging should go up to pelvic lymph node dissection only, and paraaortic is done if the pelvic nodes are positive or enlarged. So this is, we have a little reservation that now the surgical staging that as described in Berek and Hacker 7th edition is that these are the conditions in which we need a surgical staging, but then the lymphadenectomy is up to the pelvic lymph nodes. So then the surgery mainstay is always minimal invasive if it is available. So preoperative information, everything we should have in our hand, and ovaries should be removed because there's a chance of micrometastasis, and ovaries may be preserved in young women in grade 1 and grade 2. So, and the removal of vaginal cuff is not at all necessary as was thought prior. And then uterus cut open intraoperatively. Some centers, the pathologists never accept the specimen to be cut open. But I think we still follow the rule of cutting open the uterus in the OT and seeing the growth size and the myoinvasion and cervical extension, if any. So I don't know, but the SMSGO guidelines do not now favor the use of frozen section. But still, we can have some idea about the size of the tumor, the depth of the myometrial invasion, and intrauterine tumor extension. So in stage 2, again, as she has already told so nicely, we do not need to do a radical hysterectomy. And again, paraaortic lymphadenectomy also has reservations. So it's replaced by a type 1 hysterectomy and BSO with bilateral pelvic and paraaortic lymphadenectomy if indicated, like if they're enlarged or the pelvic nodes are positive. And large omental biopsy or omentectomy can be done in serous clear cell grade 3 endometrioid or carcinosarcomas, or if there is an outer half myometrial invasion or cervical extension. Appendectomy and peritoneal biopsy are done in non-endometrioid cancers. So again, types of hysterectomy. Now we know that simple versus type 1 versus type 2 have no impact on locoregional control and survival. So we have now gone back to the type 1 or the simple hysterectomy. So ESMO, ESGO, ESTRO consensus in 2016 tells us that radical hysterectomy can be opted only to obtain negative margins in stage 2 cancer. If initial surgery is not feasible, a pelvic EBRT and brachy followed by adjunctive hysterectomy with selective lymphadenectomy can be resorted to. And again, the methods, it can be laparotomy, laparoscopy, robotic, vaginal, anything can be done, and it depends on the surgeon preference and the feasibility of the surgery and the fitness of the part of the patient. So the lap to trial and the robotic surgery is beneficial, especially for the obese patients in terms of wound complication and infection rates. And open surgery is preferred. That's again subjective. If you are a good vaginal surgeon, you are a good lap surgeon, you can go ahead and do all this by a laparoscopic method. And in case you're opting for open surgery, a lower midline vertical incision or a Maillard incision or a Fennantel incision can be done. But in case you are thinking that it's a high-risk disease, you will need to do omentectomy or explore the periaortic area, it's always better to go with a midline vertical incision because it allows extension, upper abdomen can be explored properly, and a staging process facilitated. So there are so many alternative methods. I am not going to that. Again, about vaginal hysterectomy, we have enough evidence that there is no difference in the survival rates. You can take peritoneal washings from the pouch of Douglas. You can remove the ovaries. Maybe lymphadenectomy cannot be done. And if you are a lap surgeon, you can do it. But in elderly patients where we really do not need a lymphadenectomy in these patients, vaginal hysterectomy is a good method of choice. So surgical management of apparent stage 1 and 2, what
we can't hear you, ma'am.
Okay. So minimal. Now?
Yes.
Yeah. Minimally invasive surgery is the preferred surgical approach, including patients with high-risk endometrial carcinoma. Any intraperitoneal tumor spillage, including tumor rupture or morcellation, should be avoided. Okay, so if vaginal extraction, wrist, uterine rupture, other measures should be taken, like using an endobag or removing it by a mini laparotomy. And tumors with metastasis outside the uterus and cervix are relative contraindications for minimally invasive surgery. And the standard surgery is total hysterectomy with bilateral salping oophorectomy without vaginal cuff resection. Staging infracolic omentectomy should be performed in clinical stage 1 serous endometrial carcinoma, carcinosarcoma, and undifferentiated carcinoma. And there is a clue to here that it can be omitted in clear cell carcinoma and endometrioid carcinoma in stage 1 disease. So this is a little different from that which we were following previously. So staging infracolic omentectomy is done in clinical serous endometrial carcinomas, carcinosarcomas, undifferentiated carcinoma, and in grade 3 and adnexal involvement, of course, you have to do the omentectomies. So it can be omitted in clear cell and endometrioid, as I have already mentioned. So surgical management of apparent stage 1, 2, again, ovarian preservation can be considered. I think she has already discussed about it. And again, surgical treatment for stage 3 and 4 in patients with good performance status and resectable tumor followed by maximal surgical debulking should be done, followed by adjuvant therapy as tailored. So there are some controversial situations that always follows us. One is about fertility preservation. Who should manage a case of endometrial cancer? After inappropriate hysterectomy, what next we can do? And what about routine lymphadenectomy? And what about adjuvant treatment and the outcome? So coming to fertility preservation, only 4% of patients with endometrial cancer are less than 40 years. We have learned about that too much about fertility preservation. So pelvic MRI should be performed to exclude overt myometrial invasion and adnexal involvement. So the treatment for this is methotrexate progesterone acetate or megestrol acetate, and LNG IUS is also a good method now available to us to assess the, however, we have to assess the response by hysteroscopy every 3 months. If no response is achieved after 6 months, standard surgical treatment should be performed, and all the guide and THBSO should be done after completion. So this joint statement again states the same thing. I think my doctor has explained this very nicely, Dr. Shana. Fertility sparing treatment should be considered only in patients with atypical hyperplasia, EIN, or grade 1 endometrial cancers. In these patients, endometrial biopsy, preferably through hysteroscopy, must be performed. And in AH, EIN, or grade 1 endometrial carcinoma must be confirmed and diagnosed by a pathologist experienced in gynecological pathology. Radiologic imaging to assess the extension of the disease must be performed. An expert ultrasound examination can substitute pelvic MRI, that I've already told. Patients must be informed the fertility sparing treatment is not a standard of treatment. Patient must be willing to accept close follow-up and be informed of the need for future hysterectomy in case of failure of treatment and or after pregnancies. Hysteroscopic resection prior to progestin therapy can be considered, and the treatment is as I have already told. In order to assess response, hysteroscopy guided biopsy can be done. So strict surveillance is recommended every 6 months with transvaginal ultrasound and physical examination. During follow-up, hysteroscopic and endometrial biopsy should be performed only in case of abnormal uterine bleeding or atypical ultrasound findings. Hysterectomy and bilateral salpingophorectomy is recommended after childbearing due to a high recurrence rate, and preservation of the ovaries can be considered depending on the age and genetic risk factors. So then coming to the biggest gray zone is lymphadenectomy. So I think this is very simple to state that lymphadenectomy is not indicated in stage 1A, grade 1 and grade 2 endometrioid carcinoma with less than 2 cm tumor with less than 50% myoinvasion, as the nodal metastasis is less than 55% and it also increases the morbidity. So there is no therapeutic benefit, as she has already discussed. Accurate surgical staging needs full pelvic lymphadenectomy with periaortic node sampling. So in case we think we should do a lymphadenectomy, it should be a full lymphadenectomy. The role of lymph node dissection in early endometrial cancer is unclear, and controversy still remains about the indications, the anatomic extent, and the therapeutic value. Then coming to endometrial cancer, who should manage endometrial cancers? We do not really have so many gyne-oncologists so that we send all the endometrial cancers to them. So low-risk tumors have a nodal metastasis rate of less than 5% of cases and do not require forced surgical staging, can safely be operated by general gynecologists. And the greater risk of extrauterine disease who may require lymphadenectomy should be referred to a gyne-oncologist. So if you have a proper grade 1 tumor, no myoinvasion of less than 50%, I think we can go ahead, general gynecologist can go ahead and treat. Triaging can be done most effectively by thorough preoperative assessment of pathology and radiological features. So we really don't need to see the on the OT table and decide most of the time if you have a thorough pathology and radiological features. But sometimes it is necessary that you have, there may be some differences in opinion from the radiologist and in the OT. You see a deep myoinvasion and then you decide to do a lymphadenectomy. And so if it's a general gynecologist, it becomes really difficult. So endometrial cancer after hysterectomy is a common finding which we come across. So this situation can be avoided by proper pre-op evaluation of AUB before hysterectomy. And I request all my colleagues watching that whenever you are doing hysterectomy for any reason, whatever may be, routinely cut the uterus open in the operation theater and see, because many times endometrial cancer biopsy comes from the pathologist and the ovaries are removed, are preserved, and the patient again has to go back and have the ovaries removed. So unsuspected endometrial cancer, adenexa needs to be removed with staging. If diagnosed post-op, a CT PET scan of the chest, abdomen and pelvis after 4 to 6 weeks, and maybe some FNAC or serum CA125 may be done. If found abnormal, then we do a laparoscopy for completion surgery. And if all investigations are negative, endometrioid stage 1A, grade 1, grade 2, no further therapy is needed, or a lap risk-reducing salpingophorectomy max can be done. All other lesions, we may need some laparotomy, laparoscopy, or a restaging procedure. So coming to the ESMO-ESCO guidelines, surgical restaging can be considered in previously incomplete stage patients with high intermediate risk, high risk disease, if the outcome might have an implication for adjuvant treatment strategy. So you have to think, if you think that your adjuvant treatment is going to change if you do the restaging, then please go ahead and do that. And then coming to lymph node assessment, so first we have to think, is it required? Does it improve survival? Is it without increased morbidity? Is it diagnostic or therapeutic? Will it benefit? What are the prognostic importance? And still the role remains controversial. So the three roles she has already told, to assign a surgical stage for therapeutic effect in patients with positive nodes and to tailor the adjuvant therapy. So prognostic factors and nodal metastasis. So we have to know that in stage 1, the adnexal metastasis are 10%. In grade 1, it's 6%. To grade 3, it's 10%. And with the depth of invasion, if there is no invasion, it's 4%. And if the invasion is deep, it may go up to 24%. So adnexal mets correlate with pelvic and periaortic nodal metastasis. So my envision is always better to see it yourself in the OT. Sometimes it may be a huge growth in which there is a minimal myo invasion, or sometimes there may be extensive myo invasion. So the microcystic elongated and fragmented glands are a myometrial invasion pattern which is associated with angiolymphatic invasion and lymph node metastasis. So naked eye, sometimes there is a real discrepancy between the depth of invasion, and which is more with grade, the higher grade tumors. And frozen section is 88% invasion. So we may sometimes get false negative as well. So when it is a less than 2 cm and less than 50% myo invasion, so the metastasis rates are nil. So in these cases, we can safely go ahead without doing a lymphadenectomy. If it is more than 2 cm, it's 21%. If the whole endometrial cavity is involved, it may go up to 40%. So tumor size is an independent significant prognostic factor. Similarly, with the nodal status has a huge prognostic implication according as far as recurrences are concerned. So if the pelvic nodes are negative, recurrence rates are 10%, positive pelvic nodes 56%, negative periaortic 11%, positive periaortic recurrences are 59%. So this is the NCCN guideline in which we have seen that if the periaortic nodal evaluation, for if you have planned a periaortic nodal evaluation, it should go right up to the renal, include the inframesenteric as well as the infrarenal regions. So the definition of adequate lymph node dissection has not been standardized yet. Current approaches include PLND up to the level of IMA, PLND up to the renal vessels. And in endometrial cancer, two retrospective reviews have shown that patients have improved survival when at least 10 to 12 lymph nodes were removed. But I believe that so many literatures have recently shown that up to 25 nodes can be removed. And as the number of nodes go high, the pickup rates of positive node also goes high. So peritoneal cytology, wash cytology, its role is debated, but it should be done because it sometimes would aid in your management of adjuvant therapy if there is adnexal involvement. So there is a little lymphadenectomy, there's a little additional time requirement, risk of persistent lymphocyst formation. I think we have already discussed this. So lymph node count again, we have discussed. So this thing. So the decision as to the extent of surgery cannot only be based on preoperative grade status, but should be individualized based on clinical scenario. So if you have a grade 1 tumor, but it shows a extensive myo invasion or cervical extension or some adnexal disease or extrauterine disease, I think we have to take a call on that and not go only by the grade 1. So because now we have many molecular markers which have told us that grade is not the only important parameter. So many times there may be a change in grade in the post-op from that will differ.
Can't hear. Yeah, we can hear you.
Ma'am got disconnected, ma'am.
Oh, just wait. Okay. Just calling her. জয়েন করতেছি, সবাই ওয়েট করেন।
Dr. Shahan, till Dr. Bhagyalakshmi comes, can I make a comment or two?
Yes, sir. I have called her and she's joining. She told me that.
Okay,
yes,
then I'll then we'll wait.
Yes. Okay. Yes, she's joined, sir. She has joined.
Hello, can you hear me now?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so my network is a little unstable, so I'm using only my audio. So all patients of endometrial cancer should be surgically staged as it is not possible to determine. So this is a school of thought again that irrespective of the risk, you can go ahead and stage as it is not possible to determine an appropriate low stage category without nodal evaluation by a pathologist. And both in low and high risk lymph node without radiotherapy had better survival than RT without lymph node dissection. So this is a school of thought. But need for more uniform guidelines for surgical staging, at least in the low risk group, is necessary. Prospective RCTs with pooled data is the need of the day to resolve this issue. So till then, we have to individualize. So till now, we have not very definite guidance, but still we have some consensus about that. So patients with low risk endometrioid carcinoma have low risk of lymph node involvement. When RCTs did not show a survival benefit, so lymph node dissection is not recommended for these patients. And for patients with intermediate risk, deep myometrial invasion more than 50% or grade 3 superficial myometrial invasion less than 50%, lymph node dissection can be considered for staging purpose in these patients. For patients with high risk, I think lymph node dissection should be recommended. In previously incompletely operated high risk patients, lymphadenectomy to complete staging should be considered to tailor adjuvant therapy. So this is the ESMO-ESGO guideline again, that systematic lymphadenectomy is not recommended in the low risk or the intermediate risk group. Surgical lymph node staging should be performed in patients with high intermediate risk or high risk group. And when a systematic lymphadenectomy is performed, pelvic and periaortic infrarenal lymph node dissection is suggested. So presence of both macrometastasis and micrometastasis is regarded as metastatic involvement. The prognostic significance of ITC or isolated tumor cells is still uncertain. So if pelvic lymph node involvement is found intraoperatively, further systematic pelvic lymph node dissection should be omitted. However, debulking of enlarged lymph nodes and periaortic staging can be considered. So if sentinel lymph node biopsy is performed, in ICG with cervical injection is the preferred detection. Tracer re-injection is an option. Site-specific systematic lymphadenectomy should be performed in all high-risk, high-intermediate-risk, high-risk patients if sentinel lymph node is not detected on either pelvic side. Pathologic ultra-staging of sentinel lymph nodes is recommended. And no lymphadenectomy only in grade 1 or 2, less than 2 centimeter, less than 5%. And this is because the metastasis is less than 1%. So this is compiling all the data. Lymphadenectomy can be omitted in grade 1 and 2, less than 50% myo invasion, no evidence of extrauterine disease, absence of cervical involvement, tumor size less than 2 cm. Only bilateral lymphadenectomy, pelvic lymphadenectomy in grade 2 disease with tumor size more than 2 cm, paraaortic lymph node dissection if pelvic nodes were positive, and pelvic and paraaortic in grade 3 evidence of extrauterine disease, no endometrioid, endometrial, non-endometrioid endometrial cancer, depth of myo invasion more than 50%, cervical extension, and when pelvic nodes are positive. But there's a little change to this again, because the ESMO ESGO has again told that whenever we are doing in a stage 2, again, it's up to the pelvic lymph node dissection only, and lymphadenectomy can be omitted in grade 1 and 2, less than 50% myo invasion, no evidence of extrauterine disease, absence of cervical involvement, and pelvic and paraaortic lymphadenectomy in all this. So paraaortic lymph node dissection, these are the indications, and enlarged nodes are also. So because the rationale is that positive node, when the pelvic nodes are positive, around 40% nodes paraaortic nodes would be positive. Yes, I think we can rush through this video. Can you see the video?
No.
No, ma'am.
Hello? Hello?
Yes, now.
Slides and in case my net becomes better. Okay. So this is a case of a high-grade endometrial carcinoma in which actually we have done a little extended radical hysterectomy, type 2 radical hysterectomy, because there was cervical extension. Of course, now again we have changed our views, methods, after seeing that even in type 2 we can do a less radical surgery. So these are the fossae which you can see, and here the uterine artery is being held and ligated. So here you can see. And so this is again the ureter which has been dissected, but we are not going too far up to the pelvic wall. And so we are just near the uterus. And so here again the rectovaginal fossa is the rectovaginal septum is being dissected. And so we just have to go beyond the uterus so that we don't take any cervical tissue. That was the motto. And so still now we have to follow that. It's not a simple hysterectomy where you put the clamp on the uterus. So I think we have to go a little beyond the uterus so that we don't leave behind any cervical tissue in a case of endometrial carcinoma. And here you can see that we sometimes, this is the vaginal wall which is being cut. And you can cut it with the scissor or you can do it with a cautery. And after doing that, in fact, you can keep the vault open or you can close it even. But we have we follow the method that we give a bursting suture by which the opening of the vault becomes small, and it we use it as a natural drain so that we don't give any extra drains for that. And here you can see that the bursting sutures will make the vault narrower, and the hemostasis is also properly maintained. And so this is, and as of now, I think we have been doing it for the last so many years. We had never had any cause of intestinal prolapse or what they think this is a risk about. So, and this was a case in which again we had done pelvic lymph node dissection. So this is the round ligament is the landmark for doing starting the pelvic lymph node dissection. So here you can see we have applied a small retractor, and the landmark is the round ligament. And once the round ligament is retracted laterally, what comes up in view are the pelvic vessels, external iliac vessels. So this is the external iliac artery and the external iliac vein. And the last point is the crossing of the circumflex iliac vein. Here you can see nicely the circumflex iliac vein. So that is the most distal point up to which we do the lymph node dissection. So here you can see that gradually, and this is the bipolar forceps, and by which we remove the nodes. And here you can see that the bleeding is really less, so that the small feeder vessels of the nodes are all sealed when we are doing it with a bipolar. You can do it with a scissor, you can do it with a monopolar cutter, with anything. but then you should know your instrument well. So here you can see that the external iliac artery and the vein are coming up, and on the lateral side is the psoas muscle. So here you can see that all the, and here the all the nodes have come up in a block, and here you can see that the blue dye was given, and this is a sentinel node which has been removed. And this is from the obturator fossa. So when you remove the nodes from the obturator fossa, you can see the obturator nerve. So that's the main structure which you have to identify and save the structure. And of course, obturator vessels as well. So here you can see that the vessels are retracted. This is called a vein retractor or a vein loop, by which we retract the vessels laterally and go into the obturator fossa medial to the external iliac vessels. So here you can see, and that's the vein, and it's a we usually try to save this vein called the pubic vein because it's sometimes if it gets injured, it's really sometimes difficult to manage. So we try to save this pubic vein, which is the lateral most distal most vein. And so here you can see internal iliac vein. So we should remember that all the nodes, they always follow the veins. So we have to be very careful because the veins are very fragile. They are thin walled, unlike the arteries, which are very thick walled. So, and the nodes always snugly follow the veins. So here you can see that the last part of the obturator nerve is nodes are being teased up from the
You are not audible. So now is she connected? Still connected or again disconnected?
No, ma'am. She got disconnected again.
But she is connected again.
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah. I'm very sorry about that. There's some
problem.
Okay. So I think. So do we continue with the video or we go off the slides?
Yes. Continue, please.
Can you see my video?
Yes.
Okay.
You can.
Okay. So thank you so much for bearing with me, but there is some internet issue today in the whole day. Okay. So again, going ahead to the other side. So again, you can see that the nodes are being removed. So here we are using a monopolar cautery. So you can do it with a bipolar, monopolar or scissors. So monopolar, usually we use a spray mode around 30-35. And so here you can see that the veins are retracted laterally, the external iliac veins. And we are going into the obturator fossa, and here you can see that the obturator nerve is coming up so nicely, and slowly the nodes are being teased off. So we have to be really gentle when doing it because too much rushing usually lands up in so many complications. So here you can see that all the nodes have come up as a block. So here this is the anatomy which is being shown. This is the psoas muscle, and this is the external iliac vessels around the genitofemoral nerves. And so this is the uterine artery which has been ligated, and this is the obliterated umbilical. And beyond this, you can see the obturator nerve which is in the obturator fossa. And so the vault has been tied, and in a minute we will be going ahead and we'll show you the periaortic dissection, and then that will be the end of it. So this is the anatomy which is being shown, and so this is the obturator nerve. So after the end of the surgery, it is so important to identify all the structures so that we don't miss out any injury in case inadvertently we have caused. So I think it's always important to check all the structures after you have completed your procedure, including the bladder, your ureters, and everything. And you check the uterine artery stumps, all the veins, and everything has to be checked very properly, and you can give a wash. So here you can see that all the structures are passing. And so this is a picture of omentectomy because it was a high-grade ovarian cancer, high-grade endometrial cancer. Omentectomy was also done. And here you can see that the omentum is absolutely healthy. So in case you are operating on a healthy omentum, it's also possible that you preserve the arcade when you are doing it on the side of the stomach. So a large omental biopsy or infracolic omentectomy can be done, but the recent guidelines tell that if it is a clear cell, you can always do without it also. So here it's a very avascular plane, and you can do it, but sometimes you may also take help of your vessel sealer in case it's available, but without that also you can do it very nicely, but have plenty of small artery forceps, tie each of the vessels that come in your way, and then go ahead. So, and the lateral ends are of course the hepatic flexor and the splenic flexure. So here you can see the stomach. So this is the lesser sac which has opened up. So again, this is the bipolar forceps. You can use this also wherever you are thinking that it could be more vascular, and then gradually with a little retraction, you can reach up to the splenic flexure. But the crux is that before starting with the omentectomy, it's essential that you put the omentum cephalad. So here you can see that we are doing it on the stomach side, and gradually as we finish it off, so here you can see that the pancreas has also started showing, which is a retroperitoneal organ. So a proper omentectomy has a risk of omental of injury to the pancreas as well, because, and that especially near the splenic end. So here you can see this is the pancreas, and that's the end of going to be the end of the omentectomy because we have reached almost the splenic flexure. So this is the pancreas which has come up. So sometimes, and these are the stomach vessels. So in a minute you can see the spleen which will come up, and that's the end of the omentectomy from the splenic vessel. So here you can see this is the splenic, and because this part is a little vascular in here, so we have used the vessel sealer here. And once you use the vessel sealer, it's so important that you cut in small bits to be sure that proper hemostasis has taken place. And so the omentum, and this is here, the last bit of the omentum is again removed from the splenic end. So here you can see the spleen. So this is again the vessel sealer which is being used. And similarly, from this is from the stomach side, we have been away from the stomach because this is a healthy omentum. So we are trying to preserve the vascular arcade. So this you can do with the vessel sealer, but again, to remind, to reiterate that it's not necessary that always you could have all these gadgets in hand with a small artery forceps and tying each bit. It may take a little more time, but it doesn't matter at all. So now at last, when omentectomy has been finished, so the next step, this is anatomy again being shown. So this is the spleen, and so this is the liver, this is the gallbladder, everything. So it has been a real, very liberal incision because it was a high-risk endometrial cancer, and we had planned for a periaortic lymphadenectomy also. So here you can see that we are going along the line of thought. So now we'll be reflecting the peritoneum and the bowel, everything out of the peritoneal cavity. and this is the peritoneum which is being inside as we enter into the para-aortic region. So here we can see that again the method of doing this is very slow. So all the intestine has been removed. A small intestine has been removed out of the peritoneal cavity. So it's also important that to keep them protected with a gauze pack which has been properly soaked with normal saline. And here is the IP ligament, which you can see that it's turning into the IVC and it's being like dissected, separated, and being ligated at its draining point into the IVC. So this is the IP ligament. So we are tying it at its base. Base where it drains into the IVC, because it on the right side it drains into the IVC, left side on the to the left renal vein. So here we can see that the para-aortic nodes have been started dissecting. So you can see the IVC. So again, these are very slowly. So I think it's nothing to be scared about. It's a skill that has to be learned. And as the trend goes that gynecologists think that this is not our job and it's only obstetrics is our job, but I think it's not like that. I think it needs a proper training of training with good teachers. Hello?
Yes.
Yeah. So I think let me end the video there. So let's go ahead. There are some other controversies as well. So I think we have discussed about the sentinel lymphadenectomy between the controversy of doing a lymphadenectomy and not doing a lymphadenectomy. Again, we have the blue dye, the radioactive tracer, and the ICG. So it's ideal for low-risk endometrial cancers, experimental in high-risk groups. So this is again a small video to just show you how we do the sentinel lymphadenectomy. Anyway, so I think we had some adverse effects with while using the blue dye, that some allergic reactions, there may be some localized swelling or pruritus, bluish coloring of the skin. This is the urine which was collected, and bluish discoloration, and there may be transient increase in the pulse oximetry reading and some pulmonary edema. So blue dye is possible. Methylene blue ampules are injected into the onto the cervix, and the abdomen is open, and the blue nodes are taken up for biopsy. It may be one node or a group of nodes. So and if one side is negative, I think we go ahead and do the lymphadenectomy in that side. But for validating purposes, I think we need to do it 30 times and validate it so that you are sure. But still, I think there's a very emergent role of lymph node dissection, sentinel lymph node dissection. But still, we need to be very careful about all this. This is again a small video to show how ICG is given onto the cervix, and this is done by robotic surgery, in which we have a near infrared to detect the fluorescence. This is the Da Vinci system which has it. I have borrowed this video from Dr. Anupama. So here you can see the nodes which have taken the green dye and are being shown, and the lymphatic channels also appear so green. So I think, again, it's so important that you understand that sometimes you identify nodes in very peculiar positions which are not supposed to be. We never go into those areas and remove those nodes sometimes. It could be in the aortic directly or in the parametrial space. It could be in the presacral region. So that's an important advantage of doing a sentinel lymph node, in which you can identify nodes in very unusual positions. So here you can see this node has been removed and can be sent for histopathology examination. So the dye is called orogreen, and this is how it appears. So then ultra staging is important. That's the biggest advantage of doing a frozen section, because a cluster of malignant cells, epithelial cells less than 2 millimeter, called a micrometastasis, can be detected. You can detect sub-micrometastasis. And so we have to be very careful, because when we are sending off the nodes after surgery, maybe some nodes would be removed. But when we are sending some nodes only, expected that we do ultra staging of all these nodes. So it allows for real-time visual identification of the nodes, detection rates up to 88 to 100%. Patients with negative nodes will be spared of the morbidity from complete lymph node dissection. This may unnecessary exposure to radiotherapy can be avoided in patients who do not need it at all. Provides the prognostic information, but still it is at a little experimental stage and more research and prospective studies are needed. So this is the risk group stratification which we were following in 2016, but now the November 2020 ESGO ESTRO guidelines have changed it. So now we have other molecular markers also along with that to the histological classifications. So molecular classification is encouraged in all endometrial carcinomas, especially high-grade tumors. Whole mutation analysis may be omitted in low-risk and intermediate-risk endometrial carcinoma with low-grade histology. So in 2013, we had the TCGA, and in 2021, we had the PROMISE molecular classifier, which validated and simplified the surrogate of TCGA with good result. And that takes into account only P53 and MMR-INC. So in 2016, we had a classification of low-grade in which in 2020, again, it's almost the same and there's no change in the difference on in the classification. So we have added here the stage 1 and 2 with more pole mutation and stage 1A with MMRD and NSMP endometrioid carcinoma. So there is not much change in the low-risk variety. But this the intermediate variety, we have added a stage 1A endometrial cancer with high grade and LBSA negative or focal. So this ESMO ESGO guideline now states that the LBSA has to be divided into three groups. Either it's negative, focal or substantial. So we have to tell our pathologist to comment on the LBSA as whether it's negative, focal or substantial. Because when it's substantial, there is a difference in the grading of the tumor. So here you can see that if the LBSA is substantial, though it's a stage 1 endometrioid adenocarcinoma, it becomes a high intermediate, as unlike 2016 classifications. Again, a stage 2, which was initially a high risk category, is now in the high intermediate. So these are the two changes which have happened with the November ESGO ESTRO guidelines. So similarly, but the high risk has not undergone much change, except that the stage 2 has gone to the high intermediate group. And similarly, the advanced metastatic disease remains just the same. So for patients with low risk endometrial carcinoma, no adjuvant treatment is recommended. For patients with endometrial carcinoma stage 1 low risk based on pathogenic pole mutation, omission of adjuvant treatment should be considered. Adjuvant brachytherapy can be recommended to decrease vaginal recurrences. Omission of adjuvant brachytherapy can be considered, especially for patients aged less than 60 years. If P53 aberration carcinomas are restricted to a polyp or without myometrial invasion, adjuvant therapy is generally not recommended. Adjuvant brachytherapy can be recommended to decrease vaginal recurrence. EBRT can be considered for substantial LBSA. So now we understand that substantial LBSA is a very high risk factor for recurrence. And adjuvant chemotherapy can be considered, especially for high grade and a substantial LBSA. Adjuvant EBRT is recommended, especially EBRT with concurrent and adjuvant chemotherapy, or alternatively sequential chemotherapy and radiotherapy is recommended. And chemotherapy alone is an alternative option. Carcinosarcomas should be treated as high-risk carcinomas and not as sarcomas. So again, in stage 3 and 4 endometrial carcinoma, surgical tumor debulking should be done. Primary systematic therapy should be used if upfront surgery is not feasible. In cases of a good response to systemic therapy, delayed surgery can be considered, and only enlarged lymph nodes should be resected. Systematic lymphadenectomy is not recommended. So coming to recurrent disease, patients with recurrent disease should be considered for surgery only if it is anticipated that complete removal of the macroscopic disease can be achieved. For locoregional recurrence, the preferred primary therapy should be EBRT plus chemotherapy, and an easily accessible superficial vaginal tumor can be resected vaginally prior to radiotherapy. Again, in patients with a history of previous radiation, radical surgery including excentration should be considered when the intention is complete resection with clear margins. If surgery is not feasible, radical re-irradiation options include stereotactic body radiotherapy targeting the recurrence, permanent seed implants or proton therapy. In patients who only had previous brachytherapy, EBRT plus brachytherapy boost is recommended. So hormone therapy is a preferred frontline systemic therapy for patients with low-grade carcinomas without rapidly progressive disease. Progestogens, metoxyprogesterone 200 mg, megestrol acetate 160 mg are recommended. Alternative options for hormonal therapies include aromatase inhibitors, tamoxifen, fulvestrant, etc. So coming to the standard chemotherapy treatment is, as all of you know, paclitaxel, and is usually given for 6 cycles. There is no standard of care for second line chemotherapy. Doxorubicin and paclitaxel are considered the most active therapies. In patients with long platinum free interval, reintroduction of platinum can be considered. Anti-PD-1 based immune therapy with pembrolizumab could be considered for second line therapy. The combination of pembrolizumab and the multi-tyrosine kinase inhibitor lenvatinib could be considered for second line treatment of microsatellite stable carcinomas. So more recently, the use of preoperative biomarkers to identify high risk endometrial carcinomas have come into play. One is the ERPR, another is the androgen receptor, P16, MMR, HER2-neu, Ki-67 and tumor P53. So these are the IHCs which can help us to detect what is the aggressiveness of the tumor. So summarizing everything, so low risk, when there is no cervix or ischemic invasion, low grade tumors, negative peritoneal cytology, LVSI negative or focal, no evidence of metastasis. So it's a low risk disease, no adjuvant treatment is required. So it's an intermediate risk, stage 1B endometrioid, grade 1 or 2 LVSI negative or focal, stage 1A grade 3 LVSI negative or focal, type 2 endometrial carcinoma, again serous, clear cell are undifferentiated, carcinosarcoma mixed, stage 1A without myo-invasion, it's a intermediate risk. So in this, adjuvant brachytherapy can be recommended to decrease vaginal recurrence. Omission of adjuvant brachytherapy can be considered, especially for patients aged less than 60 years. So coming to high intermediate risk, so this is stage 1B endometrioid, grade 3, regardless of LVSI status, stage 1 endometrioid, substantial LVSI, regardless of grade and depth of invasion, and stage 2. So this can be divided again into two groups, if the lymph node staging has been performed, and the other in which the lymph node staging is not performed. If the lymph node staging has been done, then adjuvant brachytherapy can be recommended to decrease vaginal recurrence. EBRT can be considered for substantial LVSI, and for stage 2, adjuvant chemotherapy can be considered, especially for high grade and a substantial LVSI, and omission of any adjuvant treatment is an option also. So high intermediate risk, lymph node staging already not performed, adjuvant EBRT is recommended, especially for substantial LVSI and or stage 2. Additional adjuvant chemotherapy can be considered, especially for high grade and or substantial LVSI. Adjuvant brachytherapy alone can be considered for high grade LVSI negative and for stage 2 grade 1 endometrioid carcinomas. Then coming to high risk, that's a simple thing, stage 3, 4A endometrioid, no residual disease, non-endometrioid carcinoma, stage 1 to 4A with no residual disease, it's a high risk disease. EBRT with concurrent adjuvant chemotherapy or alternatively sequential chemotherapy and radiotherapy is recommended. Chemotherapy alone is an alternative. Carcinosarcomas should be treated as high risk carcinomas and not as sarcomas. So adjuvant radiotherapy, advanced age, grade 3 tumors or deep myometrial invasions, adverse pathologic types, high risk of recurrence, we need adjuvant radiotherapy. But again, Cochrane meta-analysis of 8 clinical trials have shown, confirmed that adjuvant PERT has no benefit on overall survival, but has some significant role on better local control. So what is the difference between EBRT versus IMRT? Currently, there is no evidence that intensity modulated radiation therapy is better than standard conformal EBRT. So coming to adjuvant chemotherapy, only certain groups of patients with high risk features, mostly type 2 endometrial carcinoma, may probably gain survival advantage. A phase 3 RCT improved progression-free survival and overall survival in relapsed stage 3 and stage 4. So coming to adjuvant hormonal treatment, multiple clinical trials and meta-analysis exploring the potential benefits of hormone treatments adjuvantly in high-risk endometrial cancer do not show any benefit. So endocrine therapy is not recommended as a post-operative adjuvant treatment. So molecular targeted therapy now have come into play. One is the angiogenesis inhibitor, mTOR inhibitors, P13 kinase inhibitors have tried with poor response, and the GOG 86P bevacizumab little superior than the temsirolimus. Pembrolizumab FDA approved to be used in MSI or MMR deficient endometrial cancer, and just on the 23rd of April, FDA has approved GSK's Jemperli, which is dostarlimab, which is a PD-1 inhibitor in MMR deficient endometrial cancer. And hormone replacement therapy, 80% of recurrence occurs within 2 years, better to withhold HRT during this period. Conjugated estrogen 0.625 milligram along with methoxyprogesterone acetate daily can be used thereafter, that is after 2 years. However, selective estrogen receptor modulators like raloxifene would be better choices. post-treatment surveillance, patient should be seen every 3 to 4 months in first 3 years, every 6 months in the third to fifth year, and annually thereafter. At each visit, complete physical and pelvic examination, a pap smear, which is sometimes controversial, but if must look at the cervix, at the vault. Ultrasonography and a CA-125 measurement, CT scan, MRI may be done when considered appropriate. And so, concluding, we need more evidence on selecting adjuvant radiotherapy, chemotherapy, and targeted therapies based on molecular alterations in endometrial cancer, and more ongoing trials and investigating adjuvant and targeted therapies for endometrial cancer. But till then, we have to individualize each of these cases and try to collect as much data as possible about the histopathology, about the imaging, and plan the treatment in a more individual way. Thank you very much for your patient hearing. And it's always a teamwork, a radiation oncologist, a pathologist, and a gynae oncologist, when we work together to formulate management for the patient, which is the best. So thank you again for your patient hearing and giving me this opportunity.